Today, I want you to experience something special. I want you to feel the wonder, confusion, and astonishment that physicists felt when they began exploring how the tiny elements we're made of behave. I want you to see how extraordinary our universe is. I want you to discover the quantum world. Let me just say that I didn't invent what I'm about to show you. I read about it in Quantum Enigma. I don't share the opinions expressed in this book, but I have to admit the explanations are outstanding. So without further ado, let's proceed to the double slit experiment, like you've never seen it before. The star of our show is an atom. Yeah, I know you can't see it. It's incredibly tiny. That's why we have this detector. We turn it on and, green light. That means the atom is there. Okay, now we're going to play with it, but first let me show you the testing ground. In order, this is the randomizing machine. It has one simple task. When we give the order, it takes an atom and places it randomly in one of these two boxes. And there aren't any tricks. The boxes are just ordinary boxes. They have two openings, one on top, so we can insert the detector to determine if the atom is inside or not, and one on the side, facing a detection screen. The atom inside the box is constantly moving, bouncing off the walls. If we uncover the side opening, the atom will shoot out and hit some point on the screen. A mark will appear on that spot, telling us exactly where the agitated atom landed. Of course, this is just a caricature of the real experiment. We cut out all the technical jargon and reduce the setup to the most basic conceptual level. For instance, instead of a wall with two slits, here we have two boxes. In any case, the conclusions we're going to reach, trust me on this, are the same as those of the real experiment. It's been done and is still being done at laboratories all around the world with the same results, driving us physicists wild with excitement. I hope you'll feel the same way by the time we reach experiment number three, but one step at a time. Experiment number one. Let's verify what we already know. We turn on the machine and the atom is randomly placed in one of the two boxes. We don't know which. Let's open one. The blue box, for instance. We raise the top, insert the detector, and green light. The atom is in the blue box. Even so, let's open the red one to see what happens. Okay, no beep. There's nothing in this box. Atom is in the blue box, red box, empty. Let's repeat the process. We switch on the machine and have a new randomly placed atom. We try our luck with the blue box and, well, nothing from the detector. It appears to be empty. Let's open the red one then. Green light. The atom was here. Blue box empty, atom in the red one. You can probably imagine what'll happen if we repeat this over and over and over again. We'll end up with a checklist where roughly 50% of the atoms were in the red box and the other 50% were in the blue box. This randomizing machine is good at its job. And of course, when the atom was in one box, the other box was always empty. Because an atom can't be in two boxes at once. Or can it? Experiment number two. Let's play with the screen. We turn on the machine and the atom is sent to one of the boxes. This time, we're going to raise the side flap on one box, say the red one, and see what happens. Suddenly, a mark appears on the screen. We open the blue box and nothing happens. Okay, let's repeat. We activate the machine and this time we open the blue box. Nothing happens on the screen. We open the red one and a mark appears. If we keep doing this, the screen will eventually be covered in dots. These dots are more or less randomly placed except for the two denser clusters directly in front of the boxes, which is what you'd expect. It's much more likely that when it leaves the box, the atom will travel in a straight line rather than at an angle. As for which box opening made a mark, the results are the same as before. About 50% of the time, it was the red box, and the other 50, it was the blue box. It's pretty clear what happened here. When we opened the box where the atom was, it shot out and hit the screen. When we opened the empty box, nothing happened. Sometimes it was in the red box, sometimes in the blue. Because obviously, the atom couldn't have come from both boxes, right? Experiment number three. Finally, we're going to open the flaps on both boxes at once, at the same time. The atom shoots out and dot on the screen. Again, we turn on the machine, open both boxes at once, and another dot appears on the screen. By now, your patience is probably wearing thin. You're thinking that it's obvious what's happening. The atom is shooting out from one of the two boxes, now we don't even know which, and hitting the screen. So if we do it a lot of times, we'll end up with the same results as experiment number two. But here is where the quantum world slaps us in the face. This doesn't happen. If we repeat the simultaneous opening of the two box flaps, we find this curious pattern. The question practically asks itself, why, instead of hitting the area directly in front of the boxes, do the atoms cluster in these zones? It makes no sense. I'm guessing that the experimenter suspected this was due to something outside the lab. For instance, maybe in the room next door, other physicists were playing with magnetic fields that somehow affected the atoms. So they nicely asked their neighbors to cut it out and, to be doubly sure, decided to try moving the boxes further apart. If you change something in your experiment and the outcome doesn't vary, that's a pretty clear sign that some external factor is influencing those results. But that wasn't the case here. When they separated the boxes and repeated the experiment, the same pattern appeared, only the clusters were farther apart. They moved the boxes closer together and the pattern followed suit. This may seem like an insignificant detail, but it actually suggests something quite ominous. It's as if the atom were in both boxes at the same time. Not two atoms or one atom split in two, the same atom in two places at once. Follow my line of reasoning. If the atom is in one of the boxes, when it shoots out, it will most likely end up in one of these zones. But those areas on the screen depend, as we've seen, on the distance between the boxes. And that's the puzzling thing. If the atom leaves one box, it can't carry any information from the other box. It can't be affected by it, because it's an empty box that plays absolutely no part in this shot. And yet, the information reaches the screen. Therefore, the only way the distance between the boxes can influence the pattern is if neither box is empty and the atom is in both boxes at once. And yes, it's true that in experiment number two, the gap between the clusters also increases if you move the boxes apart. The difference is that you know exactly which box shot each atom. If you remove one box and repeat the experiment, you get one of those two clusters. This pattern is clearly the sum of two patterns. But this doesn't happen in experiment number three. Here you can't tell what shot came from which box. And to make matters worse, the sum of the two boxes' patterns does not match the pattern you get when you open both boxes at once. In other words, both boxes are working together to create this pattern. And the only way their combined properties can make it to the screen is if the atom also has that information, being in both boxes in the exact same way. A recap. Doing experiments 1 and 2 seems to prove that the atom is inside just one box, but if I do number 3, I have no choice but to accept that it's in both. Isn't this a contradiction? Let's find out for sure. We'll repeat experiment number 3, but this time we're going to place two detectors beside the openings. That way we'll know if the atom comes from one box or both. We turn on the machine and begin. At first, it seems like the idea of the atom being in both boxes wasn't a particularly good one. With every shot, only one of the detectors lights up. The atom only leaves one box. But just when we think the world makes sense again, we look at the screen and boom. The pattern from before isn't there. We take away the detectors, repeat the experiment, and the pattern from experiment 3 reappears. We put them back, repeat the experiment, and get the pattern from experiment 2. I'll say it again. When we use detectors, the only proof we have that the atom is in both boxes vanishes, and instead we see a pattern which tells us it's in one box. Do you see what's happening here? Only when we don't know where the atom is, as in experiment 3 without detectors, can we deduce that the atom is in both boxes. It seems as if the act of determining which box the atom is in, either by inserting a detector from the top or placing it on the side, or by playing it opening first one box and then the other, is what causes the atom to be only inside one box. I'm dead serious. Believe me when I say that the old-timers racked their brains trying to understand what the atom was doing. Struggling to reconcile their classic ideas with the results of an experiment that was mocking them. And the truth is, it's still mocking us today, because some of its aspects are still being debated. For example, how is it that the atom appears to be in both boxes? Should we take this literally? And what do we, the observers, have to do with all this? What exactly does it mean to measure? Whatever the answer may be, physicists realized that they had to rethink everything, that they had to come up with a radically different theory to get a grip on this bizarre world. I'm talking about quantum mechanics. We'll explore that topic in upcoming videos. And remember, if you want more science, just hit the subscribe button. Thanks for watching.